Mental health issues are something that we find very difficult to speak about, especially in that first instance. But it's amazing how many people, when you do start talking, have experienced something probably very, very similar to what you have. I'm Kim Quine and I suffer from social anxiety. I have got to the point where I was unable to walk down a street because another person was walking the other way. I can't explain it. I had no reason. I don't know what made that happen that day, but it really took control of my life for a while. Thankfully, I got the courage and was able to go and speak to someone, speak to my doctor, and I now have some brilliant coping strategies. And no, they don't always work, and sometimes it does still take over, but just starting to talk about what was going on was really the most powerful thing that happened. There are many ways you can approach mental health issues, especially things like depression and anxiety, and one of those is exercise. So I went along to the third annual Run and Talk event that was held in Peel in September and spoke to Liam Reynolds. Can you just tell us a bit about Run and Talk to start with?
Run and Talk is an initiative by England Athletics that's to get all running clubs, run together groups and any other side affiliated groups slash teams slash clubs out and running and talking about mental health. So England Athletics are working with Mind and they are trying to essentially grow mental health awareness. Obviously mental health awareness is everyone's aware of it now, but now we need to try and work out a way of combating it. And it's a ridiculous statistic about the amount of people that are taking medication, myself included. And actually, in terms of early intervention, if people just did some activity of some description, raise their heart rate a little bit, and produce some endorphins and some other hormones, then actually it could make a big difference to the way they feel. Whereas me, I just sit in front of the telly and sit in front of the telly and sit in front of the telly, and before you know it, you're 20 years down the line and still depressed.
And I think especially among women also, but especially among men, I think it is kind of a mindset among men that almost they shouldn't talk about that and show that kind of what is perceived to be weakness, when actually it is kind of really strong to start talking about these things.
Yeah, it's funny, isn't it? Because from a guy's perspective, it's so easy just to sort of, I'm going to use the old cliche of suck it up and ignore it and it goes away. But actually it doesn't work like that at all. Mental health, it's very much a nervous system thing. It's inside, you can't control it. You can't just ignore it goes away, because unfortunately it doesn't. You know, it's easily treated in a lot of circumstances. Sometimes it's just a question of using a cognitive behaviour therapy, or even just doing some regular exercise on top of, you know, especially if you're not very active, that can make a huge difference to the way someone feels. Yeah, no, guys, don't go and speak to their doctor. It's taken me a long time to find a doctor that I wouldn't actually willing to talk to, and then to actually start talking about things that are really hurting. No, I've got a one in a million doctor, and I think I'm going to lose him soon, and that absolutely petrifies me.
And I guess it is, if you don't find that right person to start with, having the courage to keep going, which actually when you're not in such a good place can be a really difficult thing to do, to get the courage up to go and talk about it once. I know I've been there with some not severe but pretty moderate anxiety at times, and even just sitting in the waiting room waiting for that appointment, it takes everything you can not to just get up and walk out or make something else up instead of talking about it. So to have to, you know, potentially talk about it a few times to get that right person could be really daunting, and some people could give up. But what would you say to people who need to keep going?
It really doesn't matter who you speak to. Sometimes you don't even need to tell people about your problems. You just need to talk. As my position as a mental health champion and doing what I do with the running groups, there's actually quite a few people that have come to me over a period of time, not necessarily, you know, short space of time, but I'm aware of people that want to talk. And we go and have coffee, and sometimes we talk about what's going on, other times we don't talk about anything in particular. But sometimes it's just enough to help them feel comfortable and back in control. And sometimes that's what it's needed. You don't need to go and necessarily straight away talk about your problems. Just go grab a coffee with someone, go and have a chat. There's got to be somebody out there for a coffee.
And I think when you do start talking about it, I've certainly found it's surprising how many people have been in a similar position to yourself, have felt similar. And because people aren't talking about this kind of thing, you don't realise that you aren't alone and you aren't going crazy. This is actually a relatively normal thing to happen to people. It's a relatively normal way of feeling to a lot of people, yet we don't talk about it.
So there's one in four, according to the papers at the moment, that suggest can suffer from some form of anxiety or depression. One in four, there's what, 85 people here this evening, something like that? That's a lot of people that have or have had or maybe going to have soon some kind of illness. And just because, I think the problem with it is because with a physical illness, you can see it. You know, when you talk about the big ones that really are horrid, because you can see the problem, you can see what's going on. But I think with mental health, you can't see it. And it affects everybody in so many different ways that people just can't differentiate with it. So talking about it is one of the best things I ever did, because actually, the minute I stood up and said, my name's Liam, I've got depression and anxiety, and I take 150 milligrams of antidepressants every day, actually, that changed the whole plethora of people that were around me. And now I've surrounded myself with so many amazing people that actually, I'm thinking about it, you know, my doctor changed. It's not the end of the world, because I've got this great support group that's still here for me.
And away from talk and run, that isn't the only thing that you do. Throughout the year, you're holding running groups. Tell us a bit more about those.
So Liam's Run Together was an idea that came off of me doing a personal challenge to try and lift my own self-esteem. I did a marathon a few years back, and then a few mums in the playground tracked me down and said, we want to do a half marathon, can you help us? And then from that, I actually found it was something that I enjoyed doing, and it helped my own mental health. So not only going for the run, but actually going for the chat as well. So from that, turns out you can become an England Athletics run leader. And that enables me to lead groups with England Athletics with their backing and their support. Five or six times a week now, we've got this group in Peel that are absolutely amazing. And we go out, we run, we talk, we chat, we giggle, we run. Sometimes not as much as what we maybe should, but it is all about the just getting out and getting off the sofa, and not necessarily getting away from our families, but sometimes some space from the families really does help. And it's funny, because actually I don't do it as it is a business, but I don't do it as a business. So if I turn up and there's only one person there, we're going running, it doesn't matter to me. But the amount of times that I've gone for a run with an individual, and actually it's become, I don't want to say a counselling session, because it's not like that at all, but actually I do remember there was one run that I went on, this particular mum, we'll call her mum, she literally, for the entire 40 minutes we were running, she just absolutely unloaded on me. It makes me smile to this day, because when she was finished, she was just like, oh, I feel so much better for that run. Sometimes you just need to get it off your chest, and I think going for a run is a good way of doing it, because you forget you're running. You know, oh, I'm gonna go for a run, oh, that sounds tiring, you know, I can't run to the end of the street. Well, actually, no. And you know what, it doesn't matter if you can't run to the end of the street. Maybe we'll run halfway down the street. We'll do what you can do, because only you can do what you can do.
Thank you very much, Liam, for spending the time. I will shortly let you go and get your very delicious smelling pizza. But in the meantime, if there's anyone who's been listening to this who thinks, actually, it's time, I need to speak to somebody, what would your suggestion to them be?
There's a few things you can do. The first thing you can do, if you've got any sort of relationship with a doctor, is go and see your doctor. They will always listen. There's also Mind. Just search for them through your search engine. They've got such a lot of information on there to be helpful. If you feel like you need to talk to somebody, there's the Samaritans. They're 24 hours, 7 days a week. There'll always be someone there to listen and to talk. And failing that, you could always come out for a run. Liam's Run Together out in Peel. Or there's Let's Run in Douglas. Those guys over there do a great job, and they've got a big community as well of runners and people that also know what this is like. It doesn't matter what activity you do, you know, it's one in four people have been there or have done that or are going to be doing that. So even if you took up basketball or hockey or football or tiddlywinks, there's going to be someone there that knows what it feels like. So I think just getting out and talking to somebody makes the biggest difference.
And I can say from personal experience, the first time I came out with Liam's Run Together, I was nervous. And I messaged you beforehand, and I can honestly say what a warm welcome I had. And I spoke to many other of the people who come who feel the same. So I'll just take this opportunity on behalf of everyone who runs with you normally, and also the 85 so people who've turned out this evening, which is absolute testament to what you do. Just thank you and congratulations on what you've achieved so far.
Oh, that's really kind of you. Thank you very much. No, genuinely, thank you very much. It's been nice sharing the sunset with you, Kim. Don't tell Simon.
lovely as ever. We'll do it again. That event was held to raise money for Reach Isle of Man, and I was very lucky to be able to catch up with Adam Hudgeon, who is the founder of Reach, and was willing to talk to me a little bit about his own experiences and what they are trying to achieve. How important are events like this for getting the word out about what you do?
Oh, it's massive, literally massive. I mean, we have social media and we get a lot of our stuff out through social media. Within the public, when they do stuff like this, to actually, you know, walk, run and talk, like it's perfect, because that's what we're setting out to do. We're getting out to get people to talk. So if you can go and do it in a group where you can just go and walk and have a little chat to somebody, you might not even know them. It's so brilliant.
One of the things I was speaking to Liam about was along the route to let people know that there were runners about, so the people in Peel didn't think everyone had gone insane. but also to raise some awareness. They had little signs along saying, beware runners, talking about mental health, runners relieving stress, that kind of thing. So things like that are really good, aren't they? Because they let the public know, okay, there's an event going on here. But actually, there's a little bit of information there, and hopefully everyone goes away maybe slightly more aware than they were when they just went to walk their dog that evening.
Well, exactly. It's something, you know, you can go home and you speak to your family about. You know, I walked the dog and there was an event going on, you know, across the prom, and they were talking about mental health. Automatically, you've started a conversation about mental health without even realising you're doing it, which is, you know, brilliant. It's absolutely perfect.
And that's what it's all about, really, isn't it? Previously, there's been a lot of stigma around mental health. People have, for decades, not discussed it. Some people, you know, kind of didn't really believe in it as such. You know, it's hard to get past that. And I think for certain people, it is still difficult. But that's all it is, isn't it, really? It's just finding someone you trust and talk.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And there is still a stigma. But we're an island, so there's going to be a stigma. You have to remember that you can't change 80,000 people's minds. It's as simple as that. And I think mental health, good or bad, everyone has it. And it's always been around. It's just now people are starting to talk about it. And they're starting to understand that, you know, the things that have happened in their life, maybe it was due to poor mental health. You don't necessarily have to go and speak to a doctor if you don't feel like you need to. You can just pick the phone up and talk to as many organisations as the Samaritans. There's always Reach. They're doing bits. I probably missed a couple, but there's anyone. You can literally pick the phone up to any one of them and have a conversation and just put your mind at ease and have a conversation with someone. We started this with people that have dealt with mental health issues, poor mental health issues in the past. It makes that conversation so much easier to have with somebody if you've dealt with what they're going through.
And I think it's, if you feel like that in that situation, you can feel very much like you're the only person. But it's hard to remember when you're in that moment. 1 in 4 people, they say, in the UK suffer with some kind of mental health issue. That's an awful lot of people, you know, to try and remember that actually right now I feel so isolated and completely on my own, and like I'm the only person who can possibly be feeling like this. There must be something really strange about me. But actually, if you start speaking to people, it's amazing the people that you didn't realise have gone through something very, very similar themselves.
I mean, my first experience when I had a panic attack, and I left the hospital and I spoke to my doctor, and I'd sat at home for a couple of weeks, and I was saying to myself, there's no way this can be, you know, in my head. There's no way that this can be a problem with my mind. The more and more I got to learn about it, the more I was like, well, I must have the worst case of anxiety in the world, because nobody else seems to be like I am at the minute. And then I posted the story after I'd got myself out of it, and the amount of people that are dealing with this is incredible. I walk through the street now and people come up to me and they'll have the conversation of, you know, I don't go down the street, I purposely don't walk across the prom, but I don't leave my car too far away. And these are all people that you know you wouldn't have any idea. I think the stat now is 1 in 3 in any given moment will be suffering with either anxiety, depression or panic attacks,
which is huge. Yeah, and we were talking off air, just that's kind of how I realized that what I was going through wasn't, you know, was getting a little bit out of my control, really, is how it felt. So yeah, I was exactly that. I was, every day I'd go out for a walk with my little boy. He was about 18 months at the time, and I'd be pushing him in the pushchair. And I got to the point where one day I was on a very quiet street in Peel, and I went to turn down because that was the way I wanted to go, and I saw there was somebody else walking the other way up that street. And without even thinking, it was like a wall was there. I could not walk down that street, and I walked down a completely different one, a different direction to where I wanted to be going, and went a very, very long route back. And I got home and I thought, this just isn't okay. What's going on here? And I have no idea why that street, that I didn't know that person, I'm sorry, whoever it was. but it was just, that was the moment when that clicked for me. And I think I hadn't realised it before that there'd been a lot of other things leading up to it. I'd stopped going to, you know, parent and toddler groups that I'd really enjoyed before, because I'd missed one. And I thought, well, they're going to wonder why I wasn't there, and they're going to think I was rude for not going. Yeah, it just kind of snowballed to that point where it just suddenly clicked with me. This isn't all right, and I need to find a way of dealing with this before this gets worse. And for me, it was kind of not so much for me, it was more, I don't want my little boy missing out because I can't leave the house. Realistically, how many other people, and especially like other parents as well, I wasn't working at the time, wonder how many of those people are out there who are getting to that point where they haven't quite realised anything's going on, but how far it has to get before you can get some help, you feel that you need to.
You don't have to give us a call to say, you know, I'm struggling with my mental health. It could literally just be, you know, this episode has happened. Is there anything I can do differently in your situation down that street? There's breathing techniques, there's distraction that you can think of. There's lots of different techniques, but you wouldn't know at the time.
No.
Like myself, I wouldn't have known them at the time. So when I was having a panic attack, I didn't think about something differently because my mind had taken over. And it can just be one little tiny thing. That person in that street could have completely shut you down and put that wall up. There were so many people in that situation. For me, it was like a comfort blanket when I did start to speak, and I understood how many people there was that were in the same boat. I'm not the only one, so if I talk about it, a lot of people are going to understand, and I'm not going to get frowned upon. And this stigma that is there, people aren't going to follow me around and shout stuff at me. Do you know what I mean? They're not going to call me a liar. You know, these things do happen to people, like you've just stated right there with your story. Little tiny things can spiral and get bigger and bigger. Doing positive things daily for your mind and having that rest that you need, like we spoke about, things do get out of control.
It all comes very much down to self-care, doesn't it?
Exactly.
I think, especially as parents, you get so focused on this little person who needs you to do everything for them and making sure that they're okay, making sure the house is kept up, making sure everything at work. We're juggling so much, and actually, how can you look after any of those things if you're not looking after yourself?
Exactly. And this event, a simple walk or a run, can help you clear so much of that out of your mind. It really can. And talking as well while you're doing it is incredible. It is the best medicine, I suppose. It's the best medicine that I've found, is talking about it, breaking that first barrier. And as soon as I started to do it and I started to understand, everyone else around me was understanding what was going on, that's when the weight started to lift off my shoulders and I started to feel, you know what, I can go outside now. I can walk away from my car. There was little things. I couldn't go anywhere without a bottle of water, and I couldn't walk away from my car without it being in sight, because I thought, you know, these things are going to happen. And the more and more I spoke about it, the more I understood people were in the same boat and that I didn't need to worry about it that badly.
I think the thing that scared me a little bit as well is that I genuinely didn't know why this was happening.
Yeah,
and lots of people kept saying to me, well, you must have been worried about something, you know, when I've had a panic attack before, and people have said, well, you must have been worried about something, you must have been thinking about something that time. And I can genuinely say that, you know, the majority of the time when it's happened, I've been completely unprepared for it. I haven't expected it. Yeah. Of course I'm worried about something, because that makes me seem less strange at this point in time. But I think that's the thing that scared me, is that I had no idea why these things were happening or what had triggered them.
Yeah, it's in the name, isn't it? Panic. Like we said before, it's in the name panic. You think, you know, if somebody's not had a panic attack or doesn't really know much about panic attacks, then they automatically assume that you have panicked about something to make this happen. Not the case at all. Like I said to you, I was just in a bath. That was it. And I still don't know to this day why my life completely spiraled out of control and I started having these panic attacks all the time. I have no idea. And to be honest, I don't really care anymore. I really don't care because now I've got control of myself back. I've got control of my thoughts. And I know that panic attack is a panic attack. When it comes, it will go. You know, I first thought, there's no way I'm going to come back from this. This panic attack has got me now and I'm not going to see the light of day again. And then I realised that somebody said to me once, what's the worst thing that's ever happened to you having a panic attack? I said, well, I thought it was going to collapse. You know, my mum phoned an ambulance and they said, yeah, you got looked after. That is the worst thing that's happened with a panic attack. I've been looked after. So you need to realise that, you know, by leaving your car that extra little bit further away, that if you were to have a panic attack, then somebody is going to be there and somebody's going to look after you. And once you understand that that's what it is in your head, you take back control of your mind. And so now I walk and I go into situations where, you know, heightened situations. And it's strange. I say to myself in my own head, go on then. If you're going to do it now. Because I'm in front of all these people. I may as well have one now. And do you know what? It doesn't come. Because you're in control of what you're thinking. It's when you let it spiral and it's when those little, just one little thought or one little street, and you can let it get in and say, don't walk down that street because there's a person there, and you go with it, that's when it's got control of you.
Like you said, it's just that slightly different way of thinking about it. I'm going to have a panic attack and it's horrible.
Yeah.
But actually, yeah, what's the worst that is going to happen? It will pass. It isn't forever. But at the time, I think... Again, another of the things that really surprised me is it's not just a feeling, it's the physical aspect
side
of it.
Yeah.
Heart absolutely pounding. I had one at the doctor's a couple of days after, and he put me on an ECG and was about to send me to A&E because my heart was racing that much. I was sat still for absolutely no reason. And obviously as a result of that breathlessness, just feeling like something's stopping you from breathing, having to force words out. It is scary. It's not just it starts with the thoughts, but it doesn't stay inside, does it? It takes over the whole body.
But you have to understand as well that your mind and your body are one. This is one machine. Like without your physical health, your mental health isn't going to be 100%. And without your mental health, your physical health isn't going to be 100%. So, like, you go to the gym and you know, you keep fit to keep your body in shape, or if you don't do things for your mind, like rest, like eat well, like exercise, then you're not going to have both. When you do really need both.
So, if there's anyone listening who thinks, actually, I do need to do something now, can you tell us a little bit about Reach and what you guys do and what kind of aims are?
Yeah, so we started this off the back of my story. If you haven't heard it, then you can see it. It's on Reach IOM on Facebook. I posted it all on there. It's basically, we've set this up. We're not doctors. We're not medically trained people, so we wouldn't give you any medical advice on medicines to take or anything like that. We are simply there to help you understand what's going on, to sit, have a cup of tea in a nice, chilled environment, and to just break that first barrier of talking about it. If that makes you feel a little bit better, then that's job done. I got told I had to wait 18 months to see a professional, and for that 18 months, my life was in turmoil. If I had somebody there who was going through or had been through a similar thing that I could have opened up to, you know, to get little tips, podcasts to listen to, breathing techniques, that kind of thing, then that 18 months would have been a lot easier. So we set this up for that exact reason. We'd always say go and see a doctor first because that's the right thing to do, but we are there to talk and to break that first barrier, and it's in a comfortable environment. We haven't got anything yet set up, so we're doing it in, you know, we're meeting people wherever is comfortable, coffee shops, places like that. But when the funding comes, we're looking to set a place up, a nice comfortable environment where you can just come pop in and chill out and talk about what's going on in your life. It doesn't have to be, you know, a serious conversation. You can sit and just listen to our story, and if you find little tips within that can really help you, then again, job done. You can find us on Facebook, again, Reach IOM, LinkedIn, Instagram, our email address and everything's on there as well. So you can drop us a private message, or you can email us, or give us a call.
It's really about, you know, knowing that you're not alone, taking exactly. that first step to just speak
yeah.
and tell someone what you're going through. That's really, it's so important, isn't it? I think we all try and bottle it up, especially to start with. And you know, for me, it took that trigger point to think, no, I really need to tell somebody that this is yeah. happening now. It's another brilliant avenue to find other people who really do understand what you are going through and want to be there to support you, really.
That is literally it. And like I say, it's no medical advice, so you know, we're not going to tell you you need to take tablets or anything like that. If that is the case, then your doctor will tell you that. But if you want to come to us first and just sit down and explain what's going on in your life, and you want to get out before you go and sit opposite a doctor that may be a little bit scary, then come and do it. Because I can promise you, the weight that you feel lift off your shoulders when you have that conversation to say, do you know what, maybe I'm not 100%, and maybe there is something going on, just to get it out and to understand that, well, I'm 28, I play football, you know, I go out with my mates, but there's something not right with me, but there is a way out of it, because look, like, it, you know, that's what we're there to do. We're there to help, and we're there to get people, we're there to make people understand that there is ways out.
So somebody who may be listening now to this and thinks, yes, I am ready for this first step, that first conversation can feel scary. I sat in that doctor's room and almost walked out, almost, I was trying to think of other reasons I could be there, that I could make something up just so I didn't have to do it in the end. But what would you say to those people who want to have that first conversation with whoever that may be? How would you say to go about it and to get the courage to do so?
I'd say, if you really feel uncomfortable in talking to somebody, then write it down. Get out and write it down, and then you can maybe give it to somebody that you trust. If you do feel like, you know, right, it's ready, but I'm really scared, then try one of your close mates first and just explain everything that's going on and let them just listen. Once you've got that out, you'll understand that it is so much easier to let it out. And then if you come to us, you'll understand, well, you've met me for the first time today. I'm just an average guy. Like, I'm just a normal guy. I don't sit here in any professional manner. I don't have a clipboard. I will sit and have a cup of tea and listen to you, or you can just listen to me. It's as simple as that. Well, it sounds as simple as that, and I know, but I know how hard it is. But try it. That's all I can say, is just try it.
Break it down. It doesn't have to be a huge professional medical conversation. Just say what happened today.
And we can help maybe signpost to different things that are available in the Isle of Man, i.e. walk and talk, or mindfulness sessions, or gym sessions, things like that, that can just try and promote positive mental health within a person.
Thank you very much, Adam. It's been an absolute pleasure meeting you today. And if anyone is listening and was thinking of getting in touch with someone, I can genuinely say you will be met with open arms and be made to feel very, very comfortable. So there it is. We're not reinventing the wheel. We haven't, unfortunately, found a miracle cure, but we're talking. I think the main thing to take away from this is just to start talking. It doesn't matter who you speak to. Anyone that you feel confident with, you feel comfortable with, and you find to be trustworthy, just go and speak to them, and you might be surprised. I'm Kim Quine, and we've been talking about mental health.